Next, we're going to look at the effect of having property rights on teenage pregnancy. Now, in this example, there was non-compliance with treatment assignment, meaning that some households had the option of getting property rights, but they didn't actually get the titles to the land because they didn't fill out the paperwork or something like that. So, what we're going to do to deal with this problem is do an intention to treat analysis and redefine our treatment variable of interest from being having property rights to being having the option of getting property rights. So we're going to look at having a property right offer versus not having a property right offer. Our outcome variable is going to be teenage pregnancy, whether a girl is pregnant or not. And our units of analysis are girls ages 14 to 17 years old. So here, this table shows you all the data. It's basically the simplest table you'll ever see. There's only one row. And in this column, we've got among girls who lived in households who had the option of getting property rights, about 7.9% of them were pregnant. Girls who lived in households who did not have the option of getting property rights, 20.8% of them were pregnant, okay? More than twice as high as the 7.9%. The difference was minus 12.8%. This is the average treatment effect, okay? So, that's a pretty big effect. It's saying that having the option of getting property rights decreases teenage pregnancy by about 13%. It's a huge number, okay? So, is this a real causal effect that's out there? Is that really what will happen if we give people property rights, teenage pregnancy goes down by that much? Or is this something that's just an artifact of our data, just statistical noise? Well, to answer that, we have to do some statistical inference. Now, in here in this brackets, we see the number of observations in each group. So, for the households who had the option of getting property rights, there were only 63 girls. For the households who did not have the option of getting property rights, there are 24. So those numbers are pretty small. So that's why we might be worried that this number here is just statistical noise and it's not an actual effect. Okay? So we're gonna have to do the confidence interval for that. And that I've drawn right here. I've got our effect, our average treatment effect estimate, minus 0.128 minus 1.96 times the standard error, 0.091, and that's this number here from the table. That's our lower bound. Our upper bound is the same thing, except we add this second piece instead of subtract it, okay? And if you do all the algebra, you get this interval here. Now, this formula here isn't really that important to you, you know, how I got it. I just wanted to put it here to demystify things a little bit and show you where this is coming from and how you could calculate it from a table like this. So this is our 95% confidence interval. It goes from minus 31% up to positive 5%. So the important thing is, how do we interpret this? Well, first, you ask, is zero in the interval or not? Yes, it is. Okay, this interval goes from something minus to something positive. So what that means is we cannot tell that this effect estimate, minus 12.8%, it could just be due to noise, okay? It's not statistically significant. Moreover, this is a very big interval. It goes from a very large negative number, minus 31%, which is a huge effect, up to positive 5%, which would also be a pretty big effect, a bad effect that having property rights would increase teenage pregnancy, okay? It includes a large range of these things. So basically, this large interval that contains zero is telling us that our sample size is not big enough, that we can't tell whether this is a true effect or not. So, unfortunately, although we have an as-if randomized natural experiment, we might believe that justification so we can be safe to know that this is a causal effect. We just don't have a sample size that's big enough to make any conclusions about the effect of property rights on teenage pregnancy.